I volunteer as a drummer, a musician. I also do audio engineering, swap out with Mark and mix. Pretty much serve every Sunday in between. If I'm not drumming, I'm mixing. And even if Cole didn't have me down for playing drums or mixing, I'd be there helping with the setup and tear down. You know, I grew up going to church pretty much my whole life, and there came to a point where I realized, and this was about 2011, where my family was first introduced to non-denominational Christian church with a more contemporary service, and we saw volunteerism in a way that we had never seen it in a church before. My oldest is 16, and he's a athlete over at Pacific Grove High School, and we've been serving in churches since 2010 as a family, and I was kind of looking for a way to get him plugged in, and noticed that we were short of hands and just needed some muscle for setup and teardown over at PG. And he's got a bunch of these great guys who he plays football with who weren't doing anything on Sunday morning. So I said, you know what, Kai, why don't we talk to some of your friends and see if they'd be interested in coming and serving at the church. And I'm very happy to say we've got six boys who show up every Sunday. And, you know, I asked them, like, hey, how'd you like the message? And, you know, usually the answers are short. They are high school boys. I had a profound life-changing experience. I joined the military late in life. I was a post 9/11 patriot. I left the corporate career and ended up in Afghanistan, even in the Navy. And I spent a year there, and I was civil affairs officer for Western Afghanistan, and it was my job to connect with the people of Afghanistan. And in all of my time with people in villages, sitting down, you know, experiencing their culture and their hospitality, I realized that God was present in all that they did. They always thanked God. They always relied on God. They never shied away from talking about their faith. And that faith may not be our faith, but it really taught me a lesson and set an example for me. Wow, you know, I've been a Christian all my life, but I don't always exude that. I'm not sure everybody that knows me even knows that I'm a Christian. You know, I grew up in Connecticut where, you know, there's plenty of Christians there, but you never really talked about your faith outside of church. And I fell into that. And when I came back from a couple of my deployments, I started saying, you know what? I want to be a Christian in all that I do. I want people to know of my faith. I want people to ask me about it. I want to be it every day in the way I raise my kids, in the way that I'm a husband, in the way that I'm an officer, in any of the work that I do, whether it be volunteerism or just hanging out and talking with someone, you know, to be all in as my life, not just something I do on Sundays or, you know, at volunteer moments, to let it really guide who and what I am. That's living it. You want to make a change and make this place a better place. It starts with you, and our faith is such a good example of how to make this world a better place. Why not live it outside the walls of a church? Be all in. Do it. Walk it. Talk it. Be it.
Amen. We're asking this question. Will I go all in and all out for the all in all? Because he went all in and all out for me. What does it look like in your life, in my life, when we go all in and all out? Colonel Joshua Chamberlain stood on Little Round Top, this hill in Gettysburg, in the midst of this battle going on in the Civil War. He didn't know he would end up there. He actually was training as a student of theology and was a professor of rhetoric. He wasn't planning on being a soldier. But when the Civil War came, there he found himself, now a colonel, 300 men, and the Confederate Army with over 4,000 in this particular battle, looking to kind of come up this hill and take the high ground. He had one instruction: keep the high ground. Keep Little Round Top. So on July 2nd, 1863, at 2:30 in the afternoon, the Confederate Army charged and attacked. They held him off. They moved back down the hill. They charged again. They held him off. They charged again. They held him off. After a series of charges, Joshua Chamberlain evaluated his situation. He was down to 80 men of his 300 men. They each had one round of ammunition. And he was informed there would be no reinforcements. What do you do in that moment? Well, you look at your options. Retreat? Surrender? Or just try to stand your ground for one more onslaught? Because he actually had looked up in the trees where there was a young boy who was signaling the movements of the Confederate army, and the young boy had signaled, they're coming again. Retreat, surrender, hold your ground. He chose none of those. He chose to attack. 80 men. He himself had been shot in the battle in the belt buckle, and it hadn't pierced him. So with 80 men, they established a plan how to go down to try to rotate across the field. They went with a bayonet charge. And here this student of theology rhetoric professor, now colonel, stands on the wall, points down the hill, and yells one word, charge. And the soldiers go down the hill. And as this happens, other officers, other military folks that were around there see what's happening as the Union men are charging down. They join in the battle, and in 5 to 6 minutes, this unthinkable battle, in 5 to 6 minutes, over 4,000 Confederate soldiers surrender and are taken prisoner, and they win the battle. Chamberlain went on from those moments in his life to become the governor of Maine, to receive from President Grover Cleveland the Medal of Honor. And late in his life, someone asked him, what were you thinking when you decided you weren't going to retreat, you weren't going to surrender, you weren't going to hold your ground? What were you thinking when you decided that the right response was charge, attack? And this is what he said. I love this. He said this, I had deep within me the inability to do nothing. Don't you love that? I had deep within me the inability to do nothing. I knew I may die, but I also knew that I would not die with a bullet in my back. Charge. There's times in life where that's the right response. Charge, to press in. And for those who follow Jesus Christ, for those who live in the presence of this one God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, who entered human history, who loves us, who died on a cross, who rose again, who fills us with his power, we should be able to say, I find within me this deep inability to do nothing. In a world where so many people do so little, Christians should say, I'm unable to do nothing. I have to do something. And when I feel God leading, when I feel God calling, when I feel his spirit directing, when I feel it's consistent with his word, I'm ready to charge and to move forward. And this is the way it's always been for God's people. You go through the history of the Bible, and over again, there's person after person who charged forward in the power of God. Think about Joshua. Joshua in the Old Testament, facing the Jordan River at flood stage, and then these walled cities, and God says, go in and take the land. And over and over and over, he says, charge. And they go in following God. Think about Caleb. Joshua and Caleb were the only two in the Old Testament when God's people went to spy out the land. The only two spies that came back and said, it's a good land, we can do this. 10 gave a bad report, they didn't go. But Joshua went in, and Caleb is now 80 years old when they go into the land of Canaan, the promised land. He's waited 40 years in the desert to go in the promised land. So you 70 and 80 plus year old people. Caleb looks at the land and says, okay, the steepest, rockiest, toughest place with the greatest adversaries, that's the land I want. Charge. He's 80. He still has a burning passion to follow God even when it's tough and when it's challenging. Esther, think about Esther. She has to go and stand before the king of Persia knowing that if she comes to the threshold of his palace, and he doesn't raise the scepter to invite her in, she'll be executed. In that time in the world in Persia, you did not come to the king uninvited. And if you came uninvited and he didn't raise up his scepter, you were executed. But she knew to defend her people and stand for her people, she had to go and stand before the king. So there she walks and there she stands waiting. And the king raises his scepter and in she comes and she appeals for her people. And history was never the same. Esther said, charge, and moved in following after God. Think about David. Before he was King David, when he was David the shepherd boy. And God calls him to face this human tank named Goliath. He's a boy. And with a sling and five stones and lots of practice before and the power of God in him, he says, charge. And he goes in after the will of God, even though it was probably terrifying. Think about Mary, the mother of our Lord. This angel comes to Mary, who is betrothed. She's kind of pre-engagement, never been with a man. And this angel says, Mary, the Holy Spirit will come upon you and you will be with child. Our Lord will be born through you. Does she run? No, you know what she says? May it be to me as you have said. I am the Lord's servant. Charge. Take me into God's will. Probably terrified, but following the will of God. And the stories in the Bible go on and on and on. Think about the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul, who hated the church, who was killing Christians, who met Jesus and was turned around. And now the very people that he was part of that were persecuting the church are persecuting him. So he's out preaching about Jesus. They keep attacking him. And in the ancient world, in the days of the Apostle Paul, they had figured out that if they strapped a person up and took what was called a cat of nine tails, this whip, and if they whipped them 40 times, generally it would kill a person. So what they would do is they would whip them 39 times, 40 times minus one, take them within an inch of their life. The Apostle Paul kept preaching Jesus. They strapped him up, they beat him 39 times. He kept preaching Jesus. They strapped him up, they beat him 39 times. He kept preaching Jesus. They strapped him up. Five times the Apostle Paul is strapped up. 195 scars on his neck, back, sides, chest. Scars on scars. And after the fifth time, what does the Apostle Paul say? I quit, I'm out of here, hold the ground. He says, charge. And he goes in to preach again. This is our legacy, Christians. These are our forefathers and foremothers who've gone before us. And it continues through the history of the church. Read the history of the first three centuries of the church. How many people died for their faith? History says that 10 of the 12 apostles were martyred for their faith. You look at the history when Christians begin to translate the Bible, God's word, into English and German and the common languages of the common people. And the people who originally translated the Bible, most of them were killed for just translating the Bible into common languages. But they did it, and they charged forward for the sake and the glory of God. Think of our brothers and sisters in Christ around the world right now that are in places where if they're found out to be Christians, they can be persecuted, have their homes burned down, or be killed. And how many of them just say, am I retreating? Am I running? No, I press forward. That's our legacy. That's our lives if you're a follower of Jesus. Being all in and all out for the all in all is more than just a set of beliefs. It's a commitment of our lives to pursue and follow after God. And it touches the big things and the big epic moments, and it touches the little details of our life. Here's my question for you this morning. Where do you need to charge forward into God's will for your life? What's an area of your life where maybe you've retreated or you're standing still, but you're not really pressing into God's will? And I pray right now that the Holy Spirit would speak to your heart and show you at least one area where God wants you to press forward and charge forward in a way that's bigger than you ever have before. For some people, it might be if you're married. It might be in your marriage. Maybe in your marriage, you're like, I do what I have to do. I get by. I'm holding ground. And God says, no. Love your wife. Love your husband. Serve your wife. Serve your husband. Go after this thing like your life depends on it, like the glory of God is revealed in how you love your spouse, because it is. Maybe for you, it's in your financial world. You've always guarded everything you have. And God says, live for me. Surrender for me. Learn generosity like you never have before. For some of you, it's your health. You realize God's given you one body for one life. And you say, God, how do I care for this body? For some of you, that's a battle. And some of you said, I've given up on that battle. Maybe today God says, but pick up the fight again. And say, I want to have as many years of life to live for Jesus in this world, to love for Jesus in this world. Maybe it's in your friendships. Maybe you've kept God off to the side. And you've got your social life and you got your spiritual life and they're separate. And God says, bring me into your social life. Bring me into your friendships and let your faith shine even there. Maybe it's going into a lost world. Shoreline is deeply committed. Long before I was the pastor here, Shoreline decided that our mission statement was to help as many people as possible become totally committed to Jesus Christ, as many people as possible. We are on mission, and there's a world. Does our world need the love and the grace of Jesus? Oh, my goodness, does our world need the love and grace of Jesus? And we are his ambassadors. Will you hear God's call to go out into the world with his love? Maybe it's your children. And maybe your children are, 1, 2, 3, 4 years old. Maybe your children are 35, 30, 36. Maybe your children are in their 60s. But maybe God's saying you need to love your children at a deeper level. You need to model faith at a deeper level. You need to pray for your children like you've never prayed before, on a deeper level and deeper commitment than you ever have before. Whatever it is, maybe it's your spiritual life. Maybe you look and you say, well, my faith has become like a little warm cup of tea. I show up once a week, get an hour and 10, hour and 15 minutes of some music and some sermons, and I feel good for the week. But do you know the Word of God? Have you dug into the Scriptures? Are you seeking God in prayer? Are you seeking his face? Are you walking with Jesus with growing passion as each day passes? And maybe that's what God's speaking. I don't know what God's going to speak to you, but I know this. And this is the beauty of the Christian faith. I don't stand up here as a pastor and say, okay, here's what we all need to do, and here's the next 3 steps. Do that thing. I don't know what God needs to speak to you. But I know the Holy Spirit of God will speak to you. And I know if you ask God, what is it in my area that I need to go all in and all out and charge forward, God will tell you what it is. So let's do this. Let's pray right now. We're going to be opening the Bible to the story of Elisha. But before we get to the Scriptures, I want us to just come before the Spirit of God. Let's pray together. God, speak to our hearts right now. Every person in this room who has named the name of Jesus, who's come to the cross, they are filled with your Holy Spirit. You live within them. So Spirit of God, would you speak to their heart right now today? And would you show them what's that one area, or maybe one or two areas that, God, you are calling them to go all in and all out at a new level. You are calling them to charge forward and not just hold the ground and not retreat. Speak to our hearts right now in the quiet of this moment. Challenge us, Spirit of God. Convict us. What is an area that we need to surrender to you and follow you with greater passion? Just take a moment and in your own heart say, Spirit of God, where do you want to grow with me? Where do you want to take me? Living God, we come before you. And we don't want to just hold our ground. We don't want to retreat. We want to move forward for your cause in this world. And oh God, I don't know if there's ever been a time where the world needs the peace and the grace and the truth and the love of Jesus like it does now. There's just such deep needs. And we just pray that you would use us to press into your will, to follow you, to go where you would call us to go and be the people you want us to be. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Will you turn with me in your Bibles to 1 Kings chapter 19? 1 Kings 19, you'll see the Scriptures on the screen as well. If you have your Bible, turn to 1 Kings 19. And I want to read just a short portion of a story of Elisha. Now, many of you who know the Bible, you've heard of Elijah and Elisha. And sometimes you forget who goes first and how they fit together. It's really easy. Elijah and Elisha come alphabetically. E-L-I-J-A-H, E-L-I-S-H-A. So E-L-I-J, Elijah's first, Elisha follows. That's free. You'll always remember now, Elijah came first, Elisha came second, right? And so what's happening is this radical all-in moment for Elisha. Let's look together at 1 Kings 19, verse 19. So Elijah, the great prophet Elijah, went from there and found Elisha, son of Shaphat. He was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen, meaning he came from a very wealthy family. Sometimes one family would have one yoke of oxen. Sometimes a whole village would have a yoke of oxen. His family had 12 yoke of oxen, and he himself was driving the 12th pair. Elijah went up to him and threw his cloak around him. We don't know what that means, but in the ancient world, that was an invitation to become someone's mentee, protege, disciple, to follow them. So Elijah throws his cloak over the shoulders of Elisha while he's in the middle of his work. Elisha says, "Let me kiss my father and mother goodbye," he said, "and I will come with you. I'm going to follow you." "Go back," Elijah replied. "What have I done to you?" This is kind of a prophet kind of response. Prophets said all kinds of crazy stuff. But he says, "What have I done to you?" Meaning, it's not about me and what I've done. Elisha, you better know this is God calling you. I've thrown the cloak, but you better decide if you're in with this thing, if you're truly all in. Don't leave what you have to follow me unless you know you're going to be serious about it. Verse 21. So Elisha left him, went back. Now watch this. He took his yoke of oxen, not all of them, but his own yoke of oxen, and slaughtered them. He burned the plowing equipment to cook the meat and gave it to the people, and they ate community barbecue. Then he set out to follow Elijah, and watch this, and to become his servant. Not a big lofty position, a small humble position, learning and growing so he might grow into the prophet he needed to be. In this one simple little story, there's all kinds of lessons of what it means to be all in and all out and to charge forward into God's will. I want to look together at Elisha's story, and I want to find four simple lessons that I think we can take into our lives and think about when we hit those all-in moments, the big epic ones and the little daily ones, to follow Jesus. Here's four things that I think are important in those moments. If you're a note taker, you'll find in your bulletin there's a place to jot down these four key thoughts and then a few more thoughts later on. If that's helpful for you, go ahead and pull that out. But following God boldly, these are four lessons from Elisha. Number one, a defining decision. I will follow God's call on my life. There's this moment. Elijah says, what have I done? I just threw my cloak over your shoulders. But Elisha had to decide, am I in? Am I committed? Is this defining moment? And I have to make a decision. Am I going to follow Elijah? Because if I am, I'm leaving my past and I'm moving forward. My life's not going to be the same. And we all have defining moments. Sometimes small little ones where we have to make a decision. Am I going forward? Sometimes big ones. A dear friend of mine, and many of you know him, Nabil Qureshi. Nabil has preached here many times. Nabil, right now, we've been praying for him. Nabil is battling stomach cancer. Matter of fact, the doctor said that there was a 99% chance he'd never reach the point of healing where he'd have to go into phase two of this treatment. He's already in phase two. They said only 1% of people are healed enough to go to this next step. He's come to that point where he's now in the next step. So praise God for that. Keep praying for Nabil's healing. But Nabil grew up in the United States in a deeply committed, devout Muslim family. And he learned the teachings of Islam from his childhood. His parents loved him, loved his family. His dad actually worked in the U.S. military. But Nabil was raised as a Muslim. When he got into college, he began to hear the message of Jesus. He began to study the scriptures. He actually started studying the Bible to prove it wrong. And along the way, the more he studied Islam and the life of Muhammad, the more he realized it was not true and it was not life-giving. And the more he studied Jesus in the Bible, he realized it was true and life-giving, and he met God for the first time. And he was ready to commit his life to Jesus Christ. Here was the dilemma. Here was his defining moment. If he were to receive Jesus Christ and follow Jesus, he would lose his family and lose his entire circle of friends from his whole life up to that point. Because that's the way it would go. That's a defining decision. That's a moment where you have to make a decision. Am I going to follow Jesus? Nabil wrote a book called Seeking Allah, Finding Jesus, and he shares that story. If you've heard his testimony or listened to him share, it's powerful. But he came to a point where he said, if I have to choose between my family, my parents who I love, and my entire history and past, or Jesus Christ, I choose Jesus Christ. His story is amazing. Now, you and I probably aren't going to have that big of a defining moment. For me, it was different. I grew up in a non-believing, non-religious home, but I remember when I told my dad that I was a Christian and I was going to become a pastor someday, this was his response. You'll get over it. If you grew up in the church, your parents are like, oh, I'm so proud of you. That's so wonderful. My dad's like, you'll get over it. Far as I can tell, I haven't gotten over it yet. But there's those moments where I'd say, this is who I am. This is where I stand. When you hit those moments, you make a defining decision. I will follow Jesus. That's what Elisha did. That's what we do again and again as Christians. Second thing, a grand gesture. Burn the plows and have a barbecue. Now, if you are an animal rights activist and you're part of PETA and it bothers you that he slaughtered animals, all I can say is just don't think about that right now. Listen to the lesson. but you know, he basically, when he realized he was going, he made this grand gesture. He took his yoke of oxen, took his plowing equipment, made a fire, community barbecue, so everyone knew, I'm not the same Elisha you grew up with. I'm moving into a new chapter of life. I loved in the testimony on the screen here, where there's a sense of, okay, I don't even know if everybody I know knows I'm a Christian. It's not a matter of getting people's faces, but our faith should be so bold and so clear that there's a point at which people know we love Jesus because we love him so passionately. And so this grand gesture for Elisha, it was saying, I am leaving my past and I'm going to do it in a public way where everyone can see. When I became a Christian, My grand gesture, my thing, and this was the thing that defined me for about the next 3 months, is someone gave me a Bible, and they said, this is God's word, you're supposed to know it. I was 15, almost 16 years old. They gave me a Bible. I told my parents, And this is, remember, this is before cell phones, this is before computers in your bedroom. The only way you could communicate was actually like looking at a person and talking to them, or on a telephone that was tethered by a stretchy cord to a wall. Okay, different world. I'm that old. But I told my parents, I said, I'm going to get up in the morning between 7 and 8 o'clock, and I'm not coming out of my room till noon. And if my friends call or come over, tell them I can't come out and hang out. My parents said, why? I said, because they gave me this book, and they said I'm supposed to know it. So I spent 4 to 5 hours a day reading the Bible, trying to figure out what it meant and what it said. It's been over 3 decades. I still don't totally know all it means and all it says, but I keep learning. I keep growing. There's parts of the Word of God that are still mysterious to me. I think it'll be like that until I see Jesus face to face. But I dug in, and it was my way of saying to my I think my parents thought I was a little bit crazy. They thought I was losing. What kid sits in the summertime? Up to that point, I would go to the beach first light and go to Huntington Beach, and I'm sitting in my room reading the Bible. But that was what I felt God called me to do, to stand and say, this is who I am. I'm not the same guy I was before. I'm a different person today and for the rest of my life. There's points where God calls you to make a defining decision, but often that defining decision means that you do something, some kind of gesture that shows yourself and God and the world, I'm moving forward. I'm not the same person. You know, if God's speaking to you about going all in your marriage, your grand gesture might be this. When my buddies start talking about their wives and wait for me to talk about how hard it is being married, how wives are such a hassle, I'm going to say, you know what? I love my wife. I'm crazy about her, and I don't have anything bad to say about her. That'd be a grand gesture. Women, when you're with other women, non-believers or believers, and they start down that whole road of, oh, man, aren't they? And there's all that negative talk. And you say, you know what? I made a decision that God's given me the gift of my husband, and I will never speak bad of him again. Who are you? I'm the same person, but I'm not the same. I'm being changed by the power of God. Grand gestures. Defining decision, grand gesture. And then daily disciplines. Daily disciplines. Relentless following Jesus in the little things of life. I love in the passage where it says, then Elisha set out to follow Elijah and become his servant. He didn't go out to become the big prophet guy. He came out to walk in the footsteps of Elijah and learn and study and prepare for what would lie ahead. So often when we want to follow God, we want this big, massive assignment and this upfront thing. And sometimes God says, okay, here's what you're going to do. You're going to follow that person and learn. You're going to get equipped. You're going to get trained. You're going to grow for a while. You read through the Bible, when God wanted to do great things with people, he usually would send them in the desert for like 40 years first. Okay, just get prepared, 40 years. Then we'll get working on it. I mean, we want to go now. Sometimes charging forward is charging into a place of humility and being equipped for the big thing that God has. When I went through seminary, all my buddies in seminary, they wanted to, when the day they finished, I want to be a pastor in a church, the lead pastor. I want to preach. I want to be the preacher, lead pastor in a church. And most of them, that's what they did. I actually said, I don't think I'm ready to be, maybe it's because I grew up outside the church. I said, I don't think I'm ready to be a pastor, the head guy yet. I don't think I'm ready to be the lead pastor. So I went into a church, and I was actually the associate pastor under Mel DeVries, and I learned from Mel. Then I was the associate pastor under Rich Decker, and I learned a lot from Rich. Then I was this associate pastor under Henry Haga, and I learned a lot from Henry. And then I started doing my doctoral work, moved to Michigan, and people said, well, are you going to take a church there? Will you be the lead pastor? I said, I don't think I'm ready yet. And so for 4 years, I was an associate pastor under Ron Geshwin. I learned a ton from him. And then God called me to be a lead pastor and to preach. You only know me as the lead pastor. But for years, God put me in that humble place of learning and following. I was charging forward. I was just charging really slowly, walking behind somebody else. But I was where God wanted me to be. But you pursue God, and you follow God, and you humbly let him put you where he wants to put you so you can move forward. The daily disciplines, those small things of life. And here's what you discover. When you read the Bible every day, just a little bit every day, and reflect on it, after a while, you've read the whole Bible. If you say, well, I'm just going to spend one day and read a lot, and then you get worn out, just day after day. If you pray and seek the face of God every day, every day, every day, you grow in prayer. Years ago, I wrote a book called Seismic Shifts. And Seismic Shifts, the subtitle is The Little Things That Make a Big Difference in Your Life. It's all about just taking little steps every single day, faithfully, and watch the big things that God does. And this year, actually, our whole staff and our leadership team are going through Seismic Shifts together. And what we've been doing the last couple of years, we let you all know what we're going through as a staff and what we're going through as an L team if you want to come along with us and do your own study. And so there's copies of Seismic Shifts out in the foyer there, and you can get those if you want to and follow along. But the whole idea there is just every day take simple steps. That's what Elisha did when he started following Elijah and learning and get equipped and getting trained. He charged forward. He made his commitment. He made a grand gesture, and then he just started getting trained and equipped. And then God used that to grow him. And then the fourth thing, courageous commitment. Unyielding surrender to the call of God. I will follow God's call without compromise, without yielding. I'm going to keep pursuing the call of God in my life. For Elisha, as he went on in his ministry, he's getting equipped and trained, he looked at God's power and blessing and the ministry of Elijah. And Elisha actually said, I want a double portion of the blessing of the Spirit, of the power of Elijah. That seems like a strange thing to ask, because Elijah was powerful and filled with the Spirit. And Elisha says, I want a double portion of the blessing. It's interesting, if you read through the Old Testament, the record of Elisha's miracles is almost double those of Elijah. I don't know how that works, but is there something in your heart that says, God, I am not content to do nothing? As a matter of fact, I want to do all I can to be all in and live all out for the all in all, because you went all in and all out for me. You would pursue God with that kind of passion and say, God, I want more of your Spirit and more of your power and more strength to be faithful and less times that I'm stumbling and less times that I'm disobedient and less times that I'm unholy and more times that I do the right thing. I'm striving for that. I'm seeking for that. That's what we should long for, every one of us, as we follow Jesus, as we walk with him. So how do we do this? You know, I know sometimes when you hear a message, it's about being all in and being fully committed. People just want to go, okay, I'm going, I'm doing something for God, and it's kind of like ready, fire, aim, you know, I'm going to go do it, and then I'll figure out later and clean up the mess later. And I want to say, I don't think that's the wisest way. There's ways to follow God passionately and faithfully, but using the wisdom that God's given. And so here's, I say godly action follows a wise path. And if you're a note taker, there's room to write down these five words that are very important. Godly action follows a wise path. How to charge forward. First, think about it. God delights when we use our mind. Actually think. Don't just go, oh, I'm excited for God, I'm going to go do this thing. Think, is this the right thing? And I believe God's given us a mind to sort things out, to have wisdom, to think things through. And so the first thing is think, okay, Lord, I really believe you want me to pour into my marriage. I really believe you want me to pour into my family. I really believe you want me to look at my resources. You want me to think about the health of my body, my spiritual disciplines. And just think through, what's God been putting on your heart? And what do you feel? And just use the mind that God has given and identify where God wants you to go. And then even say, God, what are next steps? And God will give you lots of answers just through the mind he's given you. But then second, read about it. Does the Bible affirm this and model it? Go to the scriptures. And here's what you have to make sure of. Whatever you think God may want you to do, if what you think God wants you to do is contrary to the Bible, you're thinking wrong. God's word is always right. And there's times where we can get so wound up and just start kind of doing our thing and expect God's going to always bless our thing. And so you make sure the things I'm thinking and I believe are right to do are consistent with Scripture. Do they line up with the word of God? That's why we have to know the Bible for every part of our lives. So think about it. Read. Immerse yourself in Scripture. Read about it. Third, pray about it. Pour your heart out to God. God, will you empower me? God, is this where you want me to go? God, is this the step you want me to take? God, should I do this alone, or are there other people I should travel with down this road? And talk to God, seek God all the way down the road, communicating with God. Think about it, read about it, pray about it. And then number four, talk about it with other Christians. Get wise counsel from committed Christians. Make sure you have a couple people in your life who really love Jesus, who really know the Bible, and who know you. And when you're making a life decision to press forward, talk with them. For Sherry and I, every time we have a big life directional thing, we've got three or four couples that are scattered around the country, around the world, that we go to and say, will you pray for us and will you give us your wisdom? And we listen to them because they're really wise and they love us and they love Jesus. Us being at Shoreline didn't happen in a vacuum. We had people praying with us and for us, giving us wisdom about being here. And so do you have people in your life who you respect, who love Jesus, that you can go to and say, pray for me, and then share what God puts on your heart. Share your wisdom. And so you think, if you feel like, okay, this is the area I want to charge forward, I want to be all in and all out, and I want to start moving forward, and you say, I'm going to make a grand gesture, I'm going to make a decision, I'm going to start pursuing this. Well, think about it, read about it, pray about it, talk about it, and then finally, act on it. Get moving. Sometimes people go down the whole process. Okay, this is what I think the Lord wants, and I'm pretty sure, and I've got input, and I've read the scriptures. Okay, I know my path. I know what I'm going to do. And they just kind of wait for God to, like, shove them. And the point, if you've been praying, and if God's shown you, and if people give you counsel, and God's word affirms it, move. There's a point where you say, charge. You've done your part. You've thought. You've prayed. You've prepared. Now you just follow after Jesus, and you pursue him. All through the Bible, we see people doing that. All through the history of the church, we see people doing that. And you know, all around the church today, there's all kinds of people in this room that are following Jesus. Sometimes it's big things, sometimes it's little things. But an all-in, all-out life is one that says, when I know where God's calling, when I know what he wants me to do, and I've sought his face about it, I'm moving forward. And Christians like that change their homes and their neighborhoods and communities. And churches like that change their communities and their nation. And Christian movement around the world will change the face of this planet. But it's each one of us pursuing God and following him. And when he says move, we move. When he says charge, we go and we follow. Amen? Amen. Lord Jesus, I pray that you will send us from here with renewed passion and commitment, with conviction in our hearts by your Holy Spirit, that there is an area in our life right now, that there's not one Christian here where there isn't some area of life that you want them to charge forward, to move forward, to go all out for you. Lord, give us the courage and the strength and the commitment to live that out for the glory of Jesus, we pray. Amen.